Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the today's webinar within the video series Spotlight on Pharmaceuticals, Expert Insights on Substance Analysis. My name is Gabriele Kaiser from Netzsch Analyzing and Testing, and our guest today is Dr. Joana Pinto from the Research Center of Pharmaceutical Engineering in Austria. Hello, Joana, how are you today?
Hello, Gabi, good. And I would like to thank you very much for the invitation today to give this lecture.
Yeah, you're welcome. Would you please be so kind as to tell us a little bit more about yourself and the research center you're working in?
Of course. So as you said, my name is Joana Pinto. I have been working in research for 8 years now. I started my career at the University of Lisbon, where I was investigating the solid state of different formulations. And then about 5 years ago, I came to the RCP to do my PhD, and I did my PhD in the field of dosage form development for inhalation dosage forms. And now I still work in the development of solid dosage forms. And part of my work is related to researching how the solid state of excipients and drugs will impact the performance of these solid dosage forms. As such, at RCP, the focus of our research is on pharmaceutical development, product development, continuous API synthesis, advanced formulations, and next generation manufacturing. And within this part of our research is indeed thermal analysis that can give us an indication exactly how drug and excipients will interact.
Oh, very interesting. Your talk today will be about amorphous and mesomorphous pharmaceuticals. Yeah, so we are, I'm looking forward to it, and please go ahead.
Thank you. So materials can exist in a continuum of phases, from crystalline, where we have long range order of our atoms, to mesomorphous state, where we have a short range order, meaning that in the global aspect of the compound, we don't have long range order, but we have an order that is more in the short range scale. And then we have amorphous materials where we have no order. And the interesting fact about these materials is that they all have different thermal properties. For today, I selected three case studies. One that talks about the different distribution of water within amorphous compounds and how this affects the thermal properties and also the mobility, and also what is the impact that this will have on particle properties. Then in the second case study, which is kind of a traditional study in pharmaceutics, is the different miscibilities between a drug and a polymer. So amorphous solid dispersions is quite a well-known formulation strategy in order to improve the solubility of low soluble APIs. And as such, for us to develop amorphous solid dispersions, one critical parameter that we have to know is how our amorphous API will mix with the polymer that we will select to be an excipient in the amorphous solid dispersion. And in the third case, I will talk about the mesomorphous phases of DPPC, which is a lipid, and how DPPC interacts with different drugs. This is important because DPPC is actually an endogenous lipid within our body, and it can be that how drugs interact with this polymer might have some biologic effects that are still unknown. This is something that we should consider and should put more research on. So for our center, we use the Netzsch thermal analysis DSC Phoenix 204, and also to analyze the thermograms that we have from the equipment. We use the software also from Netzsch. So for the first case study, we have amorphous salbutamol sulfate. Salbutamol sulfate is an API, an active pharmaceutical ingredient, oftentimes used for inhalation purposes, meaning that salbutamol sulfate is normally used for the treatment of asthma, and it's inhaled as such. One way to get particles that are inhalable is to micronize them. And one technique that has been coming up in the last few years and is quite becoming famous is spray drying. But during spray drying, salbutamol sulfate becomes amorphous. And we see that it also interacts differently with water. So what we did was a stability study, seeing how the water would impact the particles of salbutamol sulfate that are amorphous. So at right after production, we have a TG at the lower temperature. And 7 days, we actually see this TG becoming two TGs. This behavior of salbutamol sulfate is quite well known and described in literature. And as such, we were not surprised to find these two TGs appearing over time. So what we see is that with aging of the samples, the two TG become more well-defined and closer to each other. Another phenomena that we also saw through time was that the increase of the onset temperature for the recrystallization event during the DSC analysis. So this was also interesting to see that indeed with the time and with maybe the water distribution within the particle, we had different crystallization kinetics, which is quite interesting and curious. But in practical means, what does this mean? So we hypothesized that due to different distribution of waters within the particle, we might have irreversible agglomeration being developed during the aging of our particles. And this might be detrimental because if we are talking about an API that has to be delivered to the lung, this API has to be well dispersed. And if it's irreversible agglomerated, this is not a situation where we want to be because the particles will be too large and they will not be able to reach the lung. So in case study two, we analyzed the miscibility of itraconazole, which is an API that is very, very unsolvable. So it's quite a good model API that is oftentimes used for the research in amorphous solid dispersions. And we saw the miscibility of itraconazole with two different polymers, PVPVA and HPMCAS, which are also two very well-used polymers in the production of amorphous solid dispersions. So what we see over here is the increased use of polymer in the mixtures with the drug. And for PVPVA, what we see is that the increase on the glass transition event becomes higher, the onset of the glass transition effect becomes higher and higher as we have more polymer in the mixture. And this is quite natural, seeing as PVPVA has a glass transition at a higher temperature than itraconazole. For the HPMCAS, we don't see actually this evolution. We see a glass transition that is, which the onset is quite stable, even when we use the different polymer concentration. And when we have more drug present, we see a second TG that we have attributed to the amorphous itraconazole that is not mixing with HPMCAS. These results were also in line with literature, with other works in literature. However, we still think that we can optimize more our thermal method and our sample preparation in order to still resolve some thermal events that we were not so sure what were. So in future, we want indeed to work on method optimization so that we can see better these thermal events. But with these first results, we were able to compare to the Gordon-Taylor, which describes the glass transition of mixtures of polymers and drugs. And we actually saw that our experimental results for PVPVA are quite in line with what is predicted by the Gordon-Taylor equation. But for HPMCAS, this is not the case, and we actually have a kind of plateau here between polymer and API. And then we have some zones that are potentially rich in our itraconazole. So what do we learn with this? We learn that PVPVA actually has an ideal mixing behavior with itraconazole and HPMCAS not. And this might have an impact on the stability of our amorphous solids dispersions. And I took the liberty to reproduce a table from Zhang from 2019 in the International Journal of Pharmaceutics, where this research group indeed did some investigation with polymers and itraconazole and how these stabilize amorphous solid dispersions. And we see that we have different behaviors for the two polymers in terms of stability, particularly when we are talking about higher relative humidities, of course, that do induce recrystallization more quickly. And in our own study, we have seen with the melt-casted samples that the two polymers do affect differently the solubility of the API. As of now, we still don't have an hypothesis why this is the case, and we need to investigate this more. However, I think the main message that I want here to communicate is that although we have amorphous solid dispersions, different polymers mix differently with the drug. And a priori, we have to evaluate this and know what are these mixing behaviors and expect that different mixing behaviors will have different impacts in stability and solubility, dissolution, and the bioavailability of the drug. So it's very important to know this before we go forward with choosing one excipient over the other. In case three, we did see the impact of drugs on the mesomorphous phases of DPPC. As I said, the DPPC is an endogenous lipid in the body. This lipid is particularly important in the lung, and as such, we have selected two two APIs that are used for the treatment of respiratory disease, salbutamol, as I explained before, and budesonide that is also used in the treatment of chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. And what we have seen, I forgot to say that also budesonide and salbutamol have quite distinct logPs, and as such, budesonide is a much more lipophilic API and salbutamol a much more hydrophilic API. And we wanted to see if due to different lipophilicities, we would also have different different interactions with the DPPC mesomorphous phases. And indeed, what we saw, so we have the main thermal event, which is the melting of DPPC, and then we have a smaller thermal event, which is the transition from the gel phase to the liquid crystalline phase of the bilipid, the lipid bilayer of DPPC. And when we see this smaller event, which is this transition between these mesomorphous phases, because in the gel phase and liquid crystalline phase, we have different short-range orders. We see that the budesonide seems to have a more extensive effect, and we have an onset of this event appearing at lower temperatures. Salbutamol also seems to partially affect the transition, and we do have the appearance of a small event at lower temperature. And it seems that both APIs do interact with our DPPC, so we wonder, could this have an impact on drug solubilization and absorption and change the bioavailability of the two drugs in the lung? Could this have adverse effects in the lung? We don't know, and these are still open questions, and this research also has the objective to put forward some hypotheses that we want to research in the future and know indeed what would be the impact of these possible interactions. This concludes my presentation. Oh, sorry.
Thank you very much for this presentation. If some of the listeners have some questions, is it possible to contact you and to discuss these questions with you?
Of course, you can send an email to joana.pinto@rcp.at.